Well, over the past few years, Australian authors have taken us around our great country to rural, remote, far-flung places. Maryrose Cuskelly has continued the journey to North Queensland and the cane fields for a murder mystery. And she joins me today for QBD Crime Club, thanks to Alan and Unwin, to talk about the cane. Maryrose, hello and welcome.
Thank you, Victoria. Hello, and hello to everyone else.
I imagine in this stop-start crazy COVID world that we've all been living in, you are so relieved to finally have the cane hitting the shelves.
Definitely I am. I actually did a lot of the writing of the cane over the, I talk about the first lockdown and the second lockdown, which just means 2020 and 2021, because they just melded into, they just kind of melded. So I did a lot of the writing for the cane over 2020 when we were in lockdown. And that was actually a really productive time for me. But, and then it was, I was quite relieved when I realised we're going to have quite a, like when the publisher let me know we'd have quite a long lead time, because I thought, oh, maybe I'll get to have a live launch and maybe I'll get to go out and speak to people. So yeah, but it is great to see it out.
We love a backstory, and yours as an author is just so interesting, because the cane is your fiction debut, but of course you've been a terrific non-fiction writer for a long time. Crime is very much in the DNA, isn't it?
Yes, and I do feel like I'm a bit of an accidental crime writer, because just even though my last two books have been so squarely within the crime genre, and that's because with Wedderburn, which was my previous book, which was true crime, it was a story I kind of came to just because there was a personal connection. So the father of a good friend of mine happened to be the good friend of a man who killed three people, admitted to it, but then was determined to plead not guilty to murder at his trial. And so that was... So just because of that close connection, I was just drawn into it and followed the story, and Wedderburn was the result. And it is true that a couple of years before that, I had written an essay about the disappearance of Marilyn Wallman in 1972. And again, I wrote about that because it was a crime that had been committed when I was a kid growing up in Queensland, and Marilyn disappeared in Mackay in North Queensland. And she was a bit older than me, but we were both country kids walking to school, and there'd been another disappearance, well, actually a murder. The children had been found after they'd been killed a couple of years before that in Townsville, which is a bit further north than Mackay as well. And these two events, they fed into just, I think, a general sense of dis-ease in Queensland and fear about children and kids walking to school and I think for my parents, particularly my mother, that was a really strong fear, and so I think I absorbed some of that. And so I had just carried that story with me for a long time, of particularly Marilyn's disappearance. And so I'd written the essay because it was only in 2015 that the Wallmans had, you know, definitive confirmation of her death, in that a piece of bone that had been found a couple of years after she went missing, they'd finally been able to extract mitochondrial DNA and link it to her mother. So they didn't have a funeral for her until 2015. And so those things had just, strengthened my interest in that case. And I was thinking of writing a longer work, and then I realized about Marilyn's disappearance, and then I realized that a lot of the things I wanted to talk about I could do better and with more freedom in fiction. And so that's how the cane came to be.
So I was thinking it would have been a scary thing to make that leap, but actually it gave you that great freedom, because you had all these things bubbling inside of you plus life experience, so you were able to kind of have the freedom.
Yeah, but but initially I wasn't thinking about the book that was to become the cane as a crime novel. I was kind of thinking about it as more kind of coming of age story with this child which it became Essie in the final book, but there was and maybe with a kind of a, I was telling my, you know, publisher and my agent, but, you know, with a touch of Australian Gothic, and I was kind of avoiding the term crime because I just thought, I can't write a crime novel, all those twists and turns. And
Yes, you can.
And it seemed too big a leap. I just to do a, you know, for my first work of fiction to be a crime novel. And then my publisher and my editor were just like, it's crime. Just accept it. It is crime.
Sorry, somebody died in not a good way.
And just get stuck into that part of it. And so the end novel, the novel that is exists in the world today, is a bit different from the original manuscript that I submitted. And I kind of had to, and when my publisher sent me the cover, like the proposed cover, and she was like, now I know what you're thinking. And she said, but really, you just have, like, just, it is crime. So just get on board.
Get on, yeah. Join the train.
That's right. And it was, you know, and it's such a, you know, amazing cover. And so I have now, you know, taken that notion of being a crime novelist, you know, to heart. I'm not pushing it away.
Own it, absolutely. Now, yeah. It is set in a fictional town in Quala, but you've written it so point detail, it could be the real thing. So obviously that for you, there's some real experience and knowledge around these cane towns in North Queensland, because they are pretty unique places.
Yeah, well, I actually grew up in the southeast corner of the state of Queensland. So we were dairy farmers, we weren't cane farmers. But, you know, I went to boarding school, so I had friends who had grown up in that district. So I had been up there a few times. And when I was researching, writing the essay about Marilyn's disappearance, I went up to Mackay and spent a bit of time driving around and kind of, you know, just parking beside a field of cane and getting out and walking around and in it and that sort of thing. And so, yeah, so that's really it was just like a bit of research, really. And but the actual town and that kind of that time and those, I suppose, the speech patterns and things like that, I suppose, do come from my childhood. I kind of remember those voices, yeah. I guess particularly of Arthur seem very familiar to me. So Arthur, who's the first person voice in it.
I should let you go back to the beginning and let's talk about it, because the book begins with there's a young girl that's been missing in the town, and the whole town is pretty much on a knife's edge and at boiling point because she's been gone for a few weeks. So take us from that beginning. And I love that first voice we hear. I felt like I was sitting down next to some old fella and he was just giving me this great big yarn. And it was such a welcoming way to come into a story that you knew was not going to be a happy story. Do you know what
yeah.
I mean?
So yeah.
Such a wonderful way to start. What made you decide to do that? And I guess give us that snapshot of the story.
Look, the cane has like a couple of, well, has several different voices. So it starts off with that first person voice, and then it goes into a third person voice from different characters' perspectives. And I don't know why I chose to do it like that. It just was something that seemed to come intuitively. And I guess I wanted, and initially that first person voice, there were several different ones, kind of undefined, and then over the revisions of the novel, it became one and became Arthur, which I think is obviously much more successful. And I suppose I just wanted someone who knew the town very well, knew the people in the town very well, and had a kind of longer and broader perspective on the town, its history, what had come before. And so that's why I went with that voice. And then with the third person voices, you know, I guess I still wanted those different perspectives and an idea of how something like a tragedy like that, how it ripples out through the community. So, you know, there's Essie, who is, you know, she's 11 or 12. She's got a perspective. Then there's, you know, Joe, who was Janet's boyfriend, and some of, and then there's like Connie, who is Essie's mother and who was very good friends with Janet's mother. And then there's Vince, who's kind of a similar contemporary to Arthur, who's the first person voice. And then there's the, you know, Earn, who's the teacher. So there's, it does sound like a lot of people are talking.
But a lot of people, but that's actually what draws you in, because you feel like you're getting to know the town and the district and what's going on. And there, it makes you pay attention, and it makes you sort of, it embeds you in the story, I guess, because you want to understand and be invested in what they're all doing. And I loved what you said earlier about you originally thought it was going to be more of a coming of age story. And I guess it is in so many ways, with young Essie and then Raylene. And, you know, there's all these teenagers hanging around the edges. And you kind of, it's that sense of, oh, foreboding, because, you know, like teenage years are kind of scary as a parent, and even when you're living them. So you're kind of watching all these kids go through all of this while there's something scary going on in the town.
Yeah, yeah, yes. And I guess those different, those different voices, you know, and because my editor was like, you know, maybe because I did have a few more, and she was like, I think we should just... maybe rationalize a few of those, which was all very good advice, I think.
Yeah, no, fantastic. I have to say, what was for me, I found that I had to keep checking myself and remembering that this was in the 70s, because it actually, some of the attitudes, the decisions, the sexism, the racism, the everything, I kept thinking, how can this only be in the 70s? Because it felt like in my mind, it was so wrong that it seemed like it should be so much longer ago. But is that a North Queensland thing, or is that just actually where Australia probably was in the 70s?
Look, I think it was where Australia was. Well, it's certainly where it was, where I was in the 70s. And, you know, a couple of people have said to me, so was it a bit exaggerated, that racism, sexism? No, I'm pretty comfortable with my memories of that time, and particularly, you know, rural areas. And no, I think it was like that. It was like that. And I went to a Catholic boarding school. And just some of the, even I was telling someone the other day, I had this economics teacher who was a Catholic priest, but, you know, just kind of would weave into the lesson how employing women was uneconomical, because every month they would have to take a day or so off work because, you know, that's, women have, you know, and that was, I don't know, it was, yeah, I'm pretty comfortable with how, with the level of sexism and racism, and I think it's pretty true to that era. Yeah,
it's and in a strange way, because there is so much sexism in the book that sometimes, I don't mean that in a negative way, what I mean is that it's like I wanted to screech at these men in the book at times, but what it was actually such a strong female book in a lot of ways as well, because you had these great women that were leading the families. You had young Essie, the female police officer who you introduced as well, and there is that line where someone offhandedly talks about she's taking a bloke's job, and oh my gosh. So it was almost like, because you gave us so much of that, it made you feel strong, like you were letting us know that women were coming, you know, the coming.
Yes, it was the beginning. And I think there was that, yes, when I say there was a lot of sexism and racism in the 70s, you know, there was, but change was a coming, you know. And I think particularly, I think Barbara, who's Janet's mother, is a indicator of that. And just even, and I think there are also good men in the story too, like, you know, and I think, you know, Eamon, who's the teacher, I think basically he's a good man. And I think, you know, Joe, who's Janet's boyfriend, he will be a good man. And you know, even the, you know, Vince, like, I think there are still good men in that, in the story as well.
But I actually wrote that, like, when I was tracking my notes from writing, I was like, oh, these mongrel men are making me cross. And I went, oh, but then I wrote, but there's a lot of really good men as well, because you can see them, and you can see how communities actually, every community has a little bit of both, doesn't it?
Yeah. And I kind of, and I think, you know, Essie is going to be, she will be a strong woman and and someone who will take kind of those lessons that she's learnt in a very, you know, maybe harsh way with her into the future. Yeah.
Interesting when we talk about those racist elements as well, because obviously being North Queensland, and it was, even when you read words like, you know, darkies, you go, oh my gosh, no one says that. But that's the way people spoke. And I really love the way you managed it, because you just, it put us there, and it was unbelievable for this era we live in. But that was the language people used, and that type of kind of, not just racism, but discrimination, it was absolutely there, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it is one of those things too, where at the time, you know, people would, if you know, if someone from the future had come back and said, sorry, you know, that's a racist term, don't you? They would go, what are you talking about? They've got dark skin, so I just call them darkies, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's kind of this, and I include myself in that. As I said, I went to boarding school. It was a, you know, it wasn't like a posh boarding school. There were lots of, you know, kids from farms like me and kids from PNG. And so there were, you know, and there were Indigenous kids there. But we were like the white kids I'm talking about. We were clueless, you know, we were so ignorant. And there was no interest in the school really either from the teachers about people's different experiences or where they'd come from. There was sort of some fantastic, you know, there were kids from PNG there whose parents, you know, were kind of in the, I suppose, the, you know, the political class of PNG, but there was no kind of curiosity about what their lives were like. There was no curiosity about the Indigenous kids' lives who were there. As I said, clueless.
So do you think, I was thinking as I was reading it in terms of there are so many different types of people this will appeal to, but I also thought for old readers, there would be a bit of that kind of sentimental, be it good or bad, about it as well, because they will remember those times, perhaps not always fondly, but it's very honest in the way you portray and the descriptions of North Queensland, but certainly Australia in that time.
Yeah, yeah. And I had sisters who were a bit older than me, and so they were like in this early 70s, they were, you know, living in Brisbane in these big sprawling share houses, and I was just so envious of them, and they were going to demos and they were coming home and arguing with my dad about politics. And so I think a lot of that has ended up in the book as well. But it was a fantastic time, I think, in Australia, in a way, in that there was that sense of change of, you know, Jermaine Greer was out and about, there was just a whole lot of things to get excited about, and this change kind of coming on the horizon. Of course, Gough Whitlam was about to be elected in 1972, so it was, there was a lot going on.
We mentioned this stunning cover. Of course, the cane, the name of the book, the cane is actually almost a character in itself. The way you've educated us in the book about the importance of the cane and for the families and the district and what went on. But it is, I've been to Childers and been there. We were filming them, lighting the fires, and we got to run the lines. And it is one of the most extraordinary experiences of my life. And the way you explain it in the book, it is really quite breathtaking, isn't it?
Yeah, I was desperate because I was, as I said, I was writing a lot of it in lockdown. I think I'm going to go up to, like, in there's only one place that they still burn cane in Australia now, which is in the Burdekin up around Eyre, and they have a whole festival around the first lighting of the cane and that sort of thing. And I was so determined to go up there for that festival in 2020, but of course, you know, COVID had other ideas. So so I had a little bit of a leap of imagination and a little bit of having to. I did speak to a cane farmer who, I think he's a retired cane farmer now, but who had, you know, been farming in the 70s. So, but it's a real spectacle. And I remember I have my friend who lived in Mackay, and she would talk about, you know, they would call it, you know, Mackay snow or something like that the ash and the embers falling from the sky, like from, you know, kilometres and kilometres away.
And I think that's when we went to Childers, it was part of a festival. They only do it this once a year for this weekend as a bit of a spectacle. And it was three parts terrifying as well as exciting, do you know what I mean? Because you can see why it creates such a dramatic backdrop for what you've done for this story. And I just need to talk about how you close out the book with the last 40 pages, so I'm not giving it anything away, but the last 40 pages is like the whole way to the end, isn't it? You really bring it all together.
Yeah, well, I suppose I just knew, okay, well, it's got to end in a big conflagration, you know, that has to be because they're burning the cane. So, and I guess that was, pulling that off, I guess, was I was kind of not worried exactly, but I was thinking, I have to really, there's all these elements and, you know, things have to happen. And so I'm glad you had that reaction.
Yeah, it's like, put it down for a moment. Okay, here we go. Is this fair to say, so the book obviously starts with Janet, she's been missing, and then throughout the book it's the search for her, and it almost in a way wasn't just who did it, it was actually more about how it impacted on the whole community in the town, because that's we could see the ramifications on so many levels. And you mentioned earlier when you were younger and those crimes, just the ramifications of someone going missing like that and what it does to everybody.
Yeah. And I think that was really what interested me the most. And I suppose earlier when I was talking about, I don't know if I want to write a crime novel, because I'm not that motivated by plot. Even when I'm even as a reader, I'm not like, you know, I like a good plot as much as anyone, but it's not why I read. And so, yes, for me, I guess the characters and that impact on the town and on the children, that was what was really interesting to me. And so I guess in some ways, in that way, it might not be, I don't know, some people might pick it up and think, and the book might not meet their expectations in that, you know, there is a propulsion, I guess, to the plot, but it might not be as many twists and turns and as many things happening in other.
It's about the characters and it's about those stories. And also that sort of, you know, the human element. I mean, yes, the attitudes were different, attitudes to women, attitudes to Indigenous, everything was different then, but still that kind of suspicion people had of each other and other people's motives, that exists today. I mean, we just use social media for it these days instead.
Yeah. And I think every community has its, you know, there are hierarchies, there are little cliques, there are circles of intrigue, there are areas of, you know, rumour and speculation and things that are known very well and things that are secrets. I think all communities have that, no matter, and, you know, in a rural, I mean, as far as fiction goes, it's kind of ripe for exploitation because it's confined, I suppose. Yeah. But in our more urban communities or in social urban communities, it's just more diffuse or something. But I think that's why.
Lots of really interesting characters around the edges. I actually really loved Ern, your school principal. Just, you know, just that, like, actually quite sensible, because there was all this furor going on around, and managed to just really cut through and deal with teenagers as teenagers, because there were so many people that were viewing them differently.
Yeah. No, actually, Ern's one of my, I like Ern too. I could have kept going back to Ern, but I thought, no, I have to just haul him back a bit. But no, I liked, and I think Ern, he's not a particular teacher of mine, but there was something in the way, particularly principals of smaller country schools, you know, they do kind of run them, I think, as little fiefdoms, and there was less kind of oversight now, and, you know, you could knock kids' heads together and,
you know. I actually reread that. Oh, I don't think you can do that anymore. You did also give us quite an education about cane toads, about divining rods. You actually had quite a bit of that kind of old school mysticism, didn't you?
Yeah. Well, yeah, and I did love all that, because I remember we had a diviner or a dowser come to our farm when I was a kid, because my dad wanted to sink a bore. And And I remember us following him and around, and I think he had wires, and I think we ended up sinking a bore where he indicated there was water, and I think there was water there. So
I feel like there's a lot of you in Essie, or a little Essie in you. Am I correct?
What do you think? Look, there is a little bit of Essie. Yeah, there is. I guess something of Essie's. I don't know. Yeah, that point of childhood where you kind of, where you're on that precipice of wanting to know more, but no one's kind of telling you stuff and they're hiding things from you. But there's also a kind of, okay, once I know these things, like Pandora's box is open and I have to deal with that knowledge. So there is a little bit of me as a kid and my memories of being a kid in Essie. And I guess that was one of the reasons why I decided to go with fiction, because I wanted to kind of mine that stuff of that age of being a kid and knowing that this stuff is going on, wanting to know, but just wary too, that once the flood gets you can't unlearn that stuff.
No, that's very, very true indeed. The setting, when you talk, we talked a bit about the cane and North Queensland. As I said, I guess right off the top, that, you know, the last few years in Australia, we've seen more amazing novels and pieces of fiction set in every part of our country. Why do you think it's so appealing and so popular right now? Because people are just lapping it up. And I feel like we've got to know Australia so much better through our novels in the last few years.
Yeah. I guess, like, it's set in a rural community, and the landscape does become kind of a character, but it's kind of a man-made landscape, the way I've chosen it. And I guess that idea and because Australia's landscape is so varied, and there is that opportunity to make it a character, whether because of its wildness or its beauty or its remoteness or its harshness. So I think that's one aspect of it. And I think too, just we were talking about before, when you have a small community and something like a crime happens, there's always that underlying dread that it's such a small community that it's someone we know, and yeah, that has its, you know, so it brings an inherent tension to the novel or whatever you're writing. So I think that's partly, and just why it's so popular. And I guess maybe perhaps it is because we've all been, because, you know, overseas travel is a bit more difficult now. We're all going, well, I need to go somewhere in Australia.
Yeah.
So
this is it. Get yourself to a cane field. Well, I hope that you can now get out and about, and as our country opens up, that you can get out and see people in person and talk about in person this terrific novel. Congratulations on the cane. Enjoy sharing the story. I think lots of people are going to really enjoy this as well. And thank you so much for joining us for Crime Club.
Oh, absolute pleasure, Victoria. Thank you very much.